I gave you a little sneak peek when we were working on respect for property in the last video. Yet here is our list for the pathway to professionalism for respect for the public. And the first is to identify your realtor and professional status at all times. Iowa law says that your communication needs to say licensed in Iowa, yet the realtor symbol, all capital letters with a registered trademark after it, is how you identify yourself as a realtor. And I think that that's probably good for a business promotion as well. The next is leave your business card unless prohibited by local rules. Now, our local rules allow us to leave business cards, but by law, we're not allowed to leave anything behind that would be advertising. I believe the example that they give is no calendars or a promotional material like that. But business cards are great. I think we've fallen out a little bit of a habit of that. I'm not sure about your market, where we're maybe not leaving business cards behind as much. And I'm okay either way with whatever your logic is. I'm going to leave that up to your business. If it's allowed, do it. If it's not allowed, don't do it. Yet the code says that it's okay. Next is encourage clients of other agents to direct your questions to that agent. We've talked a little bit about this with the preamble. And that is, if a client has an agent, make sure that you refer them back to ask all their questions through that agent. Again, it's really easy. I think sometimes buyer doesn't. I think a lot of clients, especially buyers, think we represent the house. And even when they're working with an agent, if it's not been explained to them clearly, there's an agent actually that represents the seller and represents the buyer. The commodity just happens to be a house or a piece of property. So keep that in mind and make sure that you're not having these side conversations with someone else's client. Otherwise, you might share something and the agent doesn't know it, and they're not going to feel very good about the relationship if they feel like they were purposely left out. Don't tell people what you think, tell them what you know. Now, I don't know the order of all the videos you're watching with me, to be honest. Yet I do know at some point, I believe it's coming up on a quiz later, actually, now that I think about it. There is a statement that I use that says, provide the source, don't be the source. Don't tell them what you think, tell them what you know. And don't have it be what you think about a crime rate or what you think about a neighborhood. Tell them what you know and refer them to a source that can help them make the decision. I saw another really good thing that someone posted actually on Facebook just this morning. An agent out of, I believe, the Chicago area wrote a comment that your first offer should be your best offer based on research. Now, I think that that's a really, really good statement in a market where things might be really competitive. We're at an inventory shortage. There's a lot of buyers for every listing. But I also think that's very true in a reverse market where you've got a plethora of inventory and maybe not as many buyers available. Your first should be your best, but it should be based on logic. To me, that prevents the golden term there is it avoids lowball offers. But I thought that was a really great statement that I just saw this morning. Respond promptly to inquiries. Now, I don't really know what the word promptly means. But I think it means that one, you actually do it. You don't just float off into thin air. Yet two, do have some standards for when you're going to reply. And maybe it's a quick text that says, super busy appointments until 4 o'clock. Can we talk then? I always tell new agents, and I'm saying this now because I've got to remind myself of it too. When you're in an appointment, and again, we've already talked about being focused and not distracted and not having your phone on, taking every call when you're with a client. If you're doing that, that means that after a 2-hour showing tour with some buyers, you may come back to several voicemails on your phone, correct? I am not saying that you got to return them in the order which they were received. You can return the priority. Just make sure you return all of them. And the number one I want to help promote is if you've got an appraiser that calls you that asks about a past sale, they're needing some info in order to help do their research on a current task for a current sale. There may be wanting data from a past one that you were involved in. Please return those appraiser phone calls. Again, I'm not saying it's your priority, but every time I call one back, they act surprised I took the time to help them. And either they're really good at making me feel good about returning phone calls, or that's an indicator that we're not all maybe returning those calls. First of all, it helps them do the correct data. And we want the right data because that just helps us with sales in the future as well, that everything had the correct information. And number two, if you help an appraiser and you have a question, what are they most likely to do? Probably help you out a little bit too. So it's the phrase, you scratch their back, they'll scratch yours, kind of that concept. Call if you are delayed or need to reschedule. And then the last one is explain if you're doing a cancellation. I get complaints about this all the time. Agents that just aren't showing up with no phone call, being delayed, needing to reschedule, but not calling until 15 minutes after the appointment was supposed to start. Please make sure that you're communicating. And I get it. Sometimes you've got six houses you want to show and your buyers love the first one and you think, hot diggity dog, I'm going to run back to the office to write an offer. And then you bail on those other five and don't communicate to anyone. Please make sure you've got a system in place to communicate all of that. Again, we've got showing time to handle all of these things brilliantly. You just have to follow through and do it. Keep in mind, I know we've got sellers that want to sell their house, but they also sometimes pack up 3, 4, 5 little kids in snowsuits and pop them in a vehicle in the dead of winter so that you can show a property. And to not show up, how excited do you think they're going to be to let you reschedule? Probably not very. So be careful on that one. Communicate clearly and avoid jargon and slang. I really have to work on this one myself. Of course, I try to work on all of them, but this is one that I've noticed recently using things like CMH book client or MLS or something like that, PITI, they don't know what you're talking about. And I've even used some terms like IAR or NAR with other agents that are new in the business that said, what does that stand for? And I said, Iowa Association of Realtors, National Association of Realtors. Be careful with your jargon. I need to find this, I will admit, and this should be my memory to hunt it down. I used to have a jargon cheat sheet that I would hand out in first-time homebuyer courses. That might be good to include when you're working with your buyer consultations or your seller presentations. Schedule appointments as far in advance as possible. I think that this can work two ways. One, this means the reason it was written is don't be in someone's driveway and say, we're coming in. Just because the house is for sale, people do still get ready for work and put kids to bed and have dinner and all of those things, right? And more. So we do still need to have an appointment. The point is, don't just be there with your nose pressed up against the glass wanting in. Now, we are in a market currently where if you don't get there as soon as possible, you may miss out on an opportunity because you stopped to use the restroom at Casey's on the way to the house. Things are selling pretty quickly, right? So I do understand this is a thing, but right now the market is allowing for us to get in there much, much more quickly. The other side of it is I'd be afraid to schedule things too far in advance. I've had that happen where I thought I was being proactive. I scheduled on Wednesday. I scheduled to show something on Saturday. Really easy for sellers to forget that that appointment exists, even if they approved it via showing time. So last minute, but too far in advance, I think there's a balance and it's probably on a case-by-case scenario. Of course, use your best judgment. Promise only what you can deliver. This is the idea of under-promise and over-deliver. Don't make promises that you cannot keep. You'll just set yourself up for disappointment. And more importantly, you'll set your clients up for disappointment as well. So these, again, are just a few notes about respect for public. And we are on to the next topic.